Data pipelines are the backbone of every data-driven company, but too many fail to scale properly. They crash under pressure or waste precious resources. AI models and big data isn't going to wait for slow data pipelines. They demand continuous real-time processing, which requires pipelines that can scale to handle millions and even billions of records without crashing or causing bottlenecks. A robust data pipeline guarantees that high-quality data is received on time, whether it's for AI model training or real-time predictions or analytics. So let's talk about the top techniques that we can use to build highly efficient and resilient data pipelines so that you can use them right away to solve your biggest data challenges. So to put some context around what we'll be talking about today, we're mostly going to be talking about data pipelines that are written in Python, specifically that use the Pandas library. Now, there's tons of data technologies out there for different kinds of data flows and data pipelines. You probably work with one today or you plan on building one. But essentially, all a data pipeline is an ETL process, or basically extract, transform, and load, which moves data from point A to point B. First, let's explore a few different methodologies we can use to achieve memory optimization within a data pipeline. This is one of the biggest issues that people have as they start developing their data pipelines is probably working fine, and then all of a sudden you get three times the amount of traffic, and now you're hitting memory resource limitations, which essentially causes your pipeline to fail. So let's go through a few different ways where we can actually look at our data pipelines and put in some memory optimization. So one big thing that ends up blowing out your memory is basically how much data you're pulling into your pipeline. So for that reason, we want to practice basically breaking up your data. And you want to basically do this at your extract or your read phase. So as you're bringing in your data from your source database, in all of our cases, that's going to be A. You're bringing it in. You have all your data. This is where you might start to see memory allocation issues because you just loaded in all that data, and that's what can blow out your memory. So the method we want to use is called chunking. So basically what you're going to do is you're going to chunk your data into smaller pieces so that you're only looking at a subset. And you can define this chunk of data on whatever methodology you want. You can basically define it by the amount of physical memory that's taken up, like so many gigs, or you can actually look at the number of rows or transactions that are involved. So by breaking up your reads here, you then are gonna be able to optimize the stream going forward. And this might take a little bit more time, but usually it's worth it for the trade-off of it being more resilient. Now, this is gonna really improve, again, your extract phase, your read phase, and it'll lead into optimizing your transform. However, don't forget about your load phase. You wanna do the same thing when you're loading in all your data to then be brought in. To your source. So then basically what we have is you want to mirror this kind of data breakage, because if you just put it on your reads, what's going to happen is you're still just going to hit your memory limit when you try and load all of that data all at once. So make sure you're applying this logic here as well. So you don't want to forget about your write phase in addition. So from here, basically, you can have an end-to-end pipeline and have it be much more resilient. So in that situation that I mentioned before, where now your volumes are three times bigger than you would expect, basically is going to be able to handle them in smaller pieces, and you're never going to have to redeploy your code in any of those kind of situations. Now let's think about the data that we're actually moving through this pipeline, because the data itself also takes up memory. So an area of opportunity that we can easily optimize is actually if you're working with a lot of string data, we can actually transform them into different types of data types that can be processed much faster in a more optimized way by Python and Pandas. And this is essentially done by building out categories. And basically what categories are is if you have limited data types, so you know, instead of just saying it's a string, if we know that it's going to be three different categories of data, that it's always going to be the same thing. So for example, if we know that it's always going to be just, you know, A, B, and C, you can either do them just as strings, or we can make them categories. And this data here is all the same, but by putting it in this different data type, we actually, the program itself can handle that kind of data in a much more optimized way than kind of a mystery string that could be anything. So this is much more predictable. It's easier to sort and work with data in this format. So then we can actually see how it's changing over time. And so by, again, this is a great, easy change that we can apply that's going to help save a lot of memory overall. So the other thing we want to actually, that's less of something that we should practice, but more of something that we might want to avoid, is actually avoiding some kind of recursive logic. So we want to avoid loops if we can. And this isn't just to, maybe you do need, there's real reason to add loops, but a lot of times when these have been added in the past, it's to aggregate data of some kind. Maybe you need to count something or group by something so that you're going to show the total sales for a given product. And that's going to happen somewhere in the middle of this pipeline. Now, you could do that by iterating through every line, pulling out every single product, and basically incrementing a count each time. So that's basically going to look like some kind of loop. You're going to plus one each time. That's really not going to be as optimal to do a count. But what's good is that Pandas does offer great pre-built aggregation functions. So instead of this, we can basically just do a count function. And this is going to let all that optimization basically inherit from the program itself, as opposed to you trying to write one. And this is also going to take your code probably from this function, probably when you had it in a loop. It probably took about 10 lines. This is basically going to drive it all the way down to one. So it's going to make your code easier to read and easier to interpret. But also it's going to basically be optimized. You're going to inherit a lot of that good stuff that you just get from Python and Pandas overall. So by following these methods, you can actually find a lot of great optimizations just, you know, from these basic implementations so that we can see more resiliency and that our memory optimization shouldn't get blown out. Of course, you should be monitoring your memory so you know if you're getting close to those memory limits, and you should keep an eye on it as you continue to maybe add more complexity or maybe more transformation to your pipeline. Now that we've covered memory efficiency, let's dive into failure control, which is vital for creating resilient data pipelines. I want to encourage you to be in the mindset that your data pipeline is going to fail, and that's okay. We just need to make sure that it can restart automatically without manual intervention by you or a team member. So all data pipelines should be ephemeral. They're probably deployed on a containerized environment, so they should be able to be spun up and spun down when they're needed. So let's go through a few different optimization techniques that we can apply here to make sure that our pipelines are ready to fail, but also ready to restart. So one major area where we can add in this optimization and resiliency for failure is around the actual kind of the entry point of your job in general. So this actually comes in with your schema. A large reason why you might face failures is because your data is maybe incomplete or poor data quality. You don't want that data in your source data anyway, but you basically want to make sure that we're building in these controls so that as we're bringing in data from your source system and we're going to be loading it in, we want to make sure that we're basically building a gate so that all this data we can make sure is actually matching and lining up to the schema you expect. So at the beginning of your data pipeline, always make sure that you're clearly defining the schema. so you know that each row is correct. And if you find one that isn't, maybe that is incomplete or doesn't meet your data standards, that you can kick this back early so that basically you can go forward only with the data that is actually optimized and you want moving to your next endpoint. This is actually also going to help with your memory allocation because you're not going to waste time going through the transformation and load phases for data that doesn't meet your quality standards. So another area to look at is going to be mostly around how we design our pipelines. Now, there's many different schools of thoughts about how our pipeline should be built out, but we all know they have three parts. They have ETL, but we want to make sure that in each of these, we're building out our retry logic. So we have all of our parts. ETL, nothing special. So within each of these three parts, you want to make sure that you have your resiliency built in so essentially it can fail at each piece and that you can retry. Now, you may be tempted to break these into three separate pipelines all together so that you maybe can mix and match them, maybe find some reuse. However, I would encourage you to stay away from that kind of design because generally you want more resilient pipelines that are all together. Again, that are going to carry all the way from point A to point B. By putting in breaks in the process, you're just creating interdependencies that you're going to have to manage. And you're going to have to make sure there's, you know, the proper failover and control. You're basically tripling the amount of complexity in your jobs. So by looking at this modularity, you should be still be able to build in retry logic, separate these pieces out in your code so it's highly readable, and you still can see these three clear parts. But you want to make sure that you're building retry logic basically in each piece. Retry logic, there's plenty of patterns for this. Generally, we want to make sure that if there is a small failure, you know, that it retries the defaults usually three times. So if there's a small outage or you're just rotating a key, you can basically, this job is going to restart on its own so that you don't need to have any manual intervention, but after it fails three times, then it's really going to fail. You're going to see everything crash and tear down and you'll get an error message in your logs. So make sure that you've built that in really at any critical points, but at least within each phase. So there's a clear retry catch. You don't want to wait all the way till load, you know, for at each phase of your pipeline. So another thing that we can look at is now that we know that we're failing, how do we basically know where to pick up where we left off? And this is done through checkpointing. Now, checkpointing is essentially drawing a line in the sand, saying when, you know, the last successful record, when was it pulled out? So this is essentially the next follow-up when you're working on your retry so that you can basically automatically restart after a complete failure. So let's say something went down for a few hours, you come back into the office, you're ready to, you know, kickstart your data pipeline again. How do you know where it left off? Because maybe you were loading 2 terabytes of data. Did it fail in the middle? Did it fail at the end with only a few more, you know, gigs to go? You probably don't want to start over from the beginning. So that's where checkpoints can come in handy. So that basically, as you're building in all of your different source systems and they're coming in, as you actually load them into the destination, you basically are then going to create a successful message so that we know the last successful data that was moved over. When you say it's record 456, it's usually represented by a hash or a number or something. So that let's say then it fails at the next transaction. When the restart happens, it basically is going to have this as a reference to know this is the line that we're going to start at again. So by building in checkpointing after each successful load, you're going to have a lot more resiliency. So, you know, you're making sure you're building it at the beginning of your pipeline. So you're only bringing good data in. You're going to have retry logic built in throughout. And then you're also basically going to plan for failure so that when it does happen, you're going to store this checkpoint somewhere outside of the pipeline itself. That's going to be resilient to any, you know, pod failure or anything like that. So you can basically restart this, probably automatically, but without very little manual intervention. Incorporating memory efficiency and resiliency into your data pipelines is key to scaling with big data. It ensures your AI and data workflows run smoothly without any interruptions. These best practices help you build pipelines that stand the test of time, so you'll have the tools you need to handle the growing demands of data today and tomorrow. With optimized memory usage and built-in error recovery, your pipelines will be ready for whatever comes next.